My problem is that secular Israelis defined Judaism as Orthodox so that they could reject it.
Most of this country didn't turn to them to say, hey, why didn't you fight bravely until your last drop of blood? Most of this country said, thank God you're alive because we have lost so much.
First, get out of Efrat. Then get out of Jerusalem. Then get out of Tel Aviv.
There is a way to get to a peace agreement and to a real peace between the sides.
Stop hiding our interest. Like, this is my Jewish interest. This is my Palestinian national interest. We have a common interest that no one talked about.
If you come to me and say there's going to be a two-state solution and Jerusalem's going to belong to the Jewish people, I'm going to say, what are you smoking?
In 50 years, there's no doubt in my mind, there will be a bat mitzvah at the wall. Israel will be leading the Jewish world in innovation and Jewish, we have to do it, otherwise we will perish.
The most important thing at the end of the day is that you know one simple thing. I love Israel. I love Israel. I love this country.
I'm Mark Golub, and there are many wonderful voices coming out of Israel today. And one of the most wonderful belongs to this man right here, who I'm sitting with in his home in Karnei Shomrom. What a gorgeous setting. Gorgeous setting.
How long have you lived here?
Over 20 years.
Okay. This is Moshe Feiglin, who is the deputy speaker of the Israeli Knesset, a member of Likud, who was elected in this last series of elections and is now has a voice on the Israeli scene. He has been speaking and writing and trying to influence Israeli thought for quite some time, but never before has he had the position he has had now, and he is somewhat of a controversial figure. I hope that does not in any way offend you for me to say that, but there are people who are enthusiastic about some of the things you say, and every now and then people take issue with some of the things you say. And one of the things, Moshe, that you have become associated with is speaking your mind and trying to be as honest as you can be in a political system which is not always as open and as honest as Israelis would like it to be. First of all, I want to thank you very much for inviting me to your home and letting me come here, and kol tuva hatzlacha to you in all the work you have done so far and the work you will continue to do. So thank you very, very much.
You're very welcome.
There's so many things I could begin with, and there's only so much time we have together, so I want to, you know, I would like to know something about you personally. Maybe we'll get to it later. I want to go right to the heart of the issue. In terms of the way in which Israel treats Arab population, both in Israel itself and the Arab population living on the West Bank, you've had some very serious things to say about the mistakes you think Israel has made and what you would like to see Israel do going forward. Can I ask you to summarize for the Americans who are watching, both Jews and Jews and non-Jews all over America now watching us on Shalom TV, what is the biggest mistake you think Israel has been making when it comes to, first of all, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict?
Well, Mark, I thought, when I first heard the question, I thought of starting to answer with a compliment. That your question was actually two-thirds of the solution, because you did not say Palestinians, you said Arab population.
Correct.
But then you did mention the word Palestinians.
At the end, I did use it, yes. By the way, I give you credit. That is a subtlety that I try to bring into the discussion, and you did catch it, and I think I'm already betraying my own perspective, but please, from your perspective.
You know, we deal with a problem that we by ourselves create. Even the, you know, Shelly Yachimovich, she's the head of the Labor Party. She's the second woman that had been the head of the Labor Party.
Correct.
The first one was Golda Meir.
Yes.
Golda Meir, during the 70s, came out and said, the Labor Party, yes, said, there's no Palestinian nation. Come on. Show me some archaeological site from Palestinian archaeological site, or maybe a poet from the 19th century, a Palestinian poet from the 19th century. There is no. It's an invention. that was invented only for one reason, to take that land that no one, that there was no national sovereignty on that land since the destruction of the temple and the exile of the Jewish people. So out of nowhere, we're inventing a new nation in order to take away our land. So, and while using that new speak, as George Orwell called it, okay, that a new lie, we already causing a problem that we cannot change because we ourselves are trapped in that concept, in that a new speak, in that conscience, a false conscience that not allow us to think out of that false box and solve the problem. We see today that all the national states that were forced after World War I by the British and the French, who won the war, 22 false countries, mm-hmm. based on a concept that the Arab nation don't know and don't want to know, okay? There is one big Arab nation, as their philosophers and their intellectuals admit, including Azmi Bishara, who said it openly here in Israel before he ran away for spying for the Hezbollah. Yeah. They're all crumbling down these days. It held for I don't know, since World War, about 90 years, 80, 90 years it held, and it's crumbling down. So what is our solution now? To create the 23rd Arab state, mm-hmm. that of course going to end up the same way. So first of all, we have to admit the truth. There is no Palestinians. They are Arabs that we have to treat as human beings with their human rights. But the basic assumption must be that the land of Israel, the Holy Land, belong only to the Jewish people. There is no square inch in the world that belongs to a nation more than this land belongs to the Jewish people, because God gave it to us, and because all through whole history we kept the connection to that land. Anybody who trying to take away this land from me is my enemy. That must be very, very clear. Okay, saying that from that basic understanding, we should come to solve the problem. Now, only by saying that we can solve the problem and achieve peace.
I want to make sure our audience understands, from your perspective, therefore, the concept of a two-state solution is one that you cannot accept.
Not only that I cannot accept, this is what causing the war. There is no example in human history where a group of people were given the chance to have their own state in such a strong way, money, help from all the world, including Israel, everything you want, and that state did not rise and came to reality simply because there is no Palestinian state, and a state is not what they want. Let me tell you something interesting, Mark, okay? In 1947, when the question of Palestine came to the UN, the British mandate were about to leave, mm-hmm. and the question came to the UN, and the British Empire had their mandate here for 30 years, since the end of World War I till 48, and the foreign minister of England came to the UN to explain the UN, the whole world, how he defined the problem in what they called Palestine. By the way, his name was Ernst Bevin. Mm-hmm. Ernst Bevin was not a great lover of the Jews Okay, he came out with a white paper and so on. And that's how he defined the problem. I'm telling it to you from memory, but you can check it out. This is what I'm saying is absolutely true. He said the following. The goal of the Jews in the land of Israel is to create a Jewish state in the land of Israel. The goal of the Arabs, he did not say Palestinians.
I know.
Palestinians.
Right.
He did not say that. The goal, because there was not, he knew what they are. The goal of the Arabs in the land of Israel is to avoid any kind of Jewish sovereignty in the Jewish land.
Anywhere.
They want anywhere. Right. They want a state. They want them not to have. That's the whole story.
Okay.
That's the whole story over here. One who listened to me up till now may think, okay, with Feiglin you're going to have a war. And I'm saying the opposite. Only with Feiglin you're going to have peace.
I will let you get to that.
Okay.
I want to first ask you to speak to those who are going to hear what you're saying, and they would like to say the following to you. If they have a historical sense and understand the sweep of Middle East history from the end of the 19th century on, and most Americans don't, most Jews don't.
Right.
But if they do, they would say something like this to you. You're right, by the way, there was no Palestinian people. But history has a way of moving in a certain direction, and realities change. And the Arabs who were here in the beginning of the 20th century saw themselves maybe as, first of all, they saw themselves as Arabs, they saw themselves as Syrians, they saw themselves as Jordanians, who knows? But they didn't see themselves as a separate Palestinian people. But they did see one thing. They did feel in some way some kind of attachment to the land, and they saw the Jews coming in, and at some point their leadership, the Mufti of Jerusalem, whatever, saw the Jewish immigration as a threat to them, and they didn't want the Jews here. And ultimately, in the 30s, the British basically said the only way there will ever be a solution to two peoples who both see a claim to the land is for there to be a partition. The Jews didn't like it. Within the Jewish community, there was an enormous debate. The revisionist was Jabotinsky, said both sides of the Jordan. The Yeshiva, which was basically led ultimately by Ben-Gurion, said something is better than nothing. We need a place for the Jews. We will share the land. And Moshe, from then on, the formal, overwhelming Jewish position has been, we will share the land. It's not about what God wanted. Ultimately, when the Mashiach comes, the Messiah will come one day, all of Eretz Yisrael will be Jewish. But it'll happen in stages, and at the moment we will accept a portion of the land, and we will allow the Arabs to have a portion of the land as well. And not only that, the way the UN basically drew the partition plan, it was almost bizarre what they said the infant Jewish state would be, but the Jews still said, we'll take it. And then, of course, Ben-Gurion establishes the State of Israel on May 14th, 1948, and already the Arabs were attacking. People said the next day. It wasn't the next day. Israel was already at war with all of the Arab peoples. And to this day, the Arab nation has said, you don't have a right to be here. That is basically the Palestinian-Arab position. The pan-Arab position is, there should be no State of Israel. But the Jew has said, we will share the land. And the argument that I want you to address is, setting the issue of whether God gave the land to us or not, because the Jew has said, that's not how we will play the game at the moment. What is wrong with the Jewish perspective that the way in which you ultimately solve this problem is you share the land, and that the real issue is there's nobody who wants to share the land with us. But, if there were an honest Palestinian, and I now use that word because that is what the world has designated the Arabs who live on the West Bank and in Gaza, if the Palestinian would say to the Jew, we will live with you in peace. Why won't the Jews say now, even Moshe Feiglin, okay, we will accept the Jewish perspective that began in the 30s to share the land? I wanted to know why you would not. If there were an honest Palestinian statement and commitment to live side by side with you in peace, would you be willing to do so?
Of course not. And just as I'm not willing to share my mother or my wife. But I have to tell you that they are very honest. It's us, the Israelis, actually the Jews all over the world, that are dishonest. Because what are we saying to the world? What are we saying to the world? How is the Israeli hasbara works? What do we explain, not with our mouth, with our feet, with our body language? We say the follow, and it's amazing. We say, basically, yes. And we heard it in the speech of Prime Minister Netanyahu in the Congress and in the Bar-Ilan University, that they also have the right to the land and to the middle of the land, and so in the two-state solution. Basically, what we're saying is the follow. We say, yes, we are the last colonialists in the world. What can we do? They did what they did to us in Europe. So we had to come to your land and take over in 1948 and create our own state.
You think Jews say that? This
is exactly what we're saying. Listen to me, okay? Look, when Prime Minister Rabin shook the hand of Yasser Arafat, who's the head of the Palestinian Liberation Organization from the Jews, the head of the organization that wants to liberate the land of Israel from the Jews. The PLO was created in 1964, before the 67.
That's
talking
correct.
To liberate
That's
Tel Aviv, correct. And talking to, he's till today they're talking about liberate Akko, liberate the whole land of Israel, and you're shaking his hand. Basically, agree that he has the right to say what he says. You agree with his concept.
But you know Rabin didn't agree.
I don't care what Rabin...
He made an accommodation.
Look. I know the end result. We'll talk about it soon, okay? I know the end result. You know, let's jump to the end result. The end result is that there's right now every peace talks will start from the point where the so-called Palestinians don't accept the right of the Jews to have their own state anywhere in the world. They don't willing to see Israel as a Jewish state, don't accept the concept of a Jewish state, but we accept the concept of a Jewish nation and their right to be in the land, reversed. That where we transferred in the last 20 years, since that handshake, that what happened in reality. I don't care what Rabin meant or did not mean. I don't care what Netanyahu means or not. I see where it leads us. It is leading us to a point where in the United States University, in America the University, not talking about Europe, a huge question mark is rising about the legitimacy of the state of Israel to exist. It's exactly because of that. Because the leadership of Israel never said the simplest words, this is our land. Now, when you're not willing to say that simple word that every leader in the world will say about his own, his own land, what do the world understand? It's very simple. It's not yours, it's them. Mm-hmm. Now, we are the Cossacks, the strong Cossacks. Today, they call us in Europe, in the European universities, the Nazis. In Germany, we become the Nazis, the new Nazis of the 21st century, right? We caused that. We brought it on ourselves. Because what are we really saying? By foot, not by body language, in the way we're acting. We are saying, look, we are the colonialists who took over your land in 48, 49. Then we continue taking over your land in 67. So let's have an agreement. We'll give you back what we took away in 67, and you'll give up what we took away from you in 48. That is the basic hasbara of the Israelis, and we think that the world will buy that? Excuse me, Mark, excuse me, Israelis, I'm the world are fed up with this concept. There's one side who's talking about justice, there's one side who's talking about pragmatic, but your pragmatism is the pragmatism of the wolves, of the robbers. I don't care anymore about your peace talks. If it's not yours, just take yourself out and leave. And if the Germans and the Polish gave you problems in 48, we'll find you a different place. Maybe you go to Australia or buy yourself an island. You have a lot of money today, and you can manage. This is where hasbara, where this is where, when as you said, leave aside the question of if God gave mm-hmm. it to us or not. Mm-hmm. And this is exactly what happens when you leave it aside. Mm-hmm. You see, that's the real danger. It's not about security. It's not about financial. It's not about human rights. We have all the rights to be here. I have a peace plan. I have a peace plan, a real peace plan. If my plan I have a plan that's really going to bring peace to the region.
However,
we know already where that concept of dividing the land led us until today. Only more and more bloodshed, wars, and so on.
Yes, by the way, I think you're absolutely right. It's interesting. There is something called realpolitik. I don't know how your philosophy, even if some people accept it emotionally, works in today's real world. So I do want you to explain to us what your alternative would be. And also, just before you do, you are a member of Likud. The number one person in Likud is now the Prime Minister of Israel, Benjamin Netanyahu. What you're also telling our audience is that you, from within the same party, have a serious philosophical disagreement with the Prime Minister of Israel, who is the leading member of your own party.
That's true, but not with the Likud philosophy, not with the Likud chart. The first sentence in the Likud chart says, the whole land of Israel, from the Jordan River, every part of the land of Israel that are being held by the IDF belongs to us and only to us.
And why is it from the Jordan River as opposed to both sides of the Jordan River? Why was Jabotinsky wrong, in your opinion?
I don't think he was wrong.
Then why is it only from the Jordan River?
But the Likud decided...
For what reason? Against you?
Against me.
Okay. Yes. Because if you had your way, it would not be from the Jordan.
Look, I believe...
Right?
I'm answering you. I believe that every part of the land of Israel, of the promised land, that the Israeli army being forced to get to, should remain in the Israeli sovereignty. Yes.
If the Israeli army controls it, from then on it belongs to us again.
Right, right.
Because it was law, part of ancient...
Just as we have the law of return for human beings, for Jews, we should have the same law to every part of the land of Israel. And believe me, Mark, when the Arabs will know that they have what to lose, today they have only what to gain. They can lose a lot of human lives, but we see in Syria how much they care about that. When they will know that, yes, we do look at the promised land as, in principle, our land, you know what we'll have? We'll have peace. They will not dare go to war when they will know, really understand, they're going to lose land.
So if you were Prime Minister, what would you
say? Now, what is the plan?
Yes,
what is the plan? Now, forget about that question.
That's a real philosophical question.
I'm talking about what is the plan right now? First of all, you have to make sure, and this is the most important thing, to make sure that the Israeli population, the education system in Israel, between Jews and themselves, educate our kids, our youth, ourselves, that this is our land. See the land? We are sitting now at the tribe of Menashe land. The hills behind us belongs already to the tribe of Ephraim. This is where our roots are. Okay, I can open the Tanakh, the Bible, and show you exactly where we are. Okay, yes. This is our land.
Yes, and so everybody now says we are on what is called the West Bank. Karnei Shomron is on the West Bank. It's in Judea Samaria. Continue. Yeah,
yes, it's the West Bank of the Jordan. It's in Judea and Samaria. if you open the map, you'll find and look for Karnei Shomron. You'll see that it's right in the center of the country. There's no way to divide that country. There's no moral reason to do that. However, after you understand that, you have to understand. So basically the question is, what do you do with the Arabs? So let's first of all understand what is the problem. Right now there is 1.4 million Arabs in Gaza. Unfortunately, we left Gaza, so that's not a problem right now. We're not there. There is another 1.1 million Arabs here in Judea and Samaria. Okay. And another 250, maybe a little bit more, thousand Arabs in what they call East Jerusalem that also got an Israeli ID. So basically the problem is with 1.1 million Arabs in Judea and Samaria, and these are the real numbers, okay? You can look at the Yoram Ettinger researchers and so on. The real number is 1.1 million. About 250 families, 50,000 families. Now, do you know how much money Israel spent on the concept of Oslo, dividing the land, you know, since the Oslo process, since this horrible, horrible handshake with Rabin and Arafat? About half a trillion shekels. Israel is spending every year between 5 and 10%, depends how you're looking at it, what you include or not, on that false concept that brings only more and more bloodshed. With that amount of money, you can give or pay or buy or help, you name it. Just as we have in Israel, Sal Klita, you know what a Sal Klita is? Whether we give every Ole Chadash, there is Sal.
Any new immigrant to Israel.
Okay. Should create the same kind of basket to those who are willing to leave.
You'd pay them to leave.
Help them. Now, I'm not going to pay them to leave. I'm going to do something else. In their own surveys, I'm talking about the Anajach University and Birzeit University, not ours, their own surveys, 65% of them expressed their wish to find their future in a better place than here. 65% without getting anything. They want to leave.
And go where?
Okay, so on one hand, you see basically they want to go.
Where?
Wait. On the other hand, there are countries who definitely need that kind of immigration. You know, the question, who is going to build the skyscrapers in Montreal is not if it's going to be a Canadian or that were born in Montreal. The question is it going to be an immigrant from Africa that build mud houses in Sudan, or in those Arab population from Shechem and Ramallah who build Tel Aviv? They lived near a modern society and they have skills much more than the other immigration that comes from Africa. So I'm talking about Montreal, countries in Europe, Dubai, and other places in the world. There are places, there is a huge wave of immigration today in the world. We're talking about here very small quantities. We're talking about 350,000 families altogether. And I'm talking about a process of a 10, 15, 20 years. Look at what we did in the last 20 years with a false concept. Now let's come with a new solution for the coming 20 years instead of giving our children another war. Let's give the next generation a real peace.
Is your sense, though, that they would take money to go somewhere else?
Let me tell you. So they want to leave. They want them to come. And we have a lot of money that we're spending anyhow on barbed wires, on missiles, that we missiles against missiles and so on.
I understand.
To create that process, to urge that process, to let that process happen.
Bottom line is, you think there is a significant percentage of the Arab population living now on what's called the West Bank, would take money and go to Montreal.
Not only money, any kind of help.
But do you want to expel them?
Yes.
Do you want to expel them?
I don't want to expel them.
You want to encourage them to leave. Incentives to leave.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. And it's not big numbers as it's shown. It's not big numbers. Demography works today in favor of the Jews even without moving anyone from his home, by the way. Mm-hmm. It's not true that it doesn't. However, this is our land. I want to reduce the numbers of the Arabs in Yehuda v'Shomron by encouraging them to leave.
I understand.
I want to, of course, annex the land, build more and more cities all over the land that will make the prices in Tel Aviv normal again, flourish the land, having on the long run, everybody should understand that the Jewish future is here and the Arab past is here.
All right, two quick questions for you. Do you think that there is any significant population of Israelis who would endorse your plan? Do you think that there is any Palestinian leadership that would endorse this plan?
What's nice about this plan, about the Israelis, of course.
Of course?
Of course. No, you know, the point is that I'm saying things that other leaders are afraid to say. But once you're saying that, here, for example, I told you there is no Palestinian people. You do not fall from your chair. You know it's true, right? But
until, yes, but I think I'm unusual.
But until I came and start explaining that more and more, no one else had the guts to say the truth. So there must be that boy that says the king is naked, right? The emperor in no clothes. The king is naked. So you have to start saying that. You have the courage to start saying the truth and show the way, and you have to run to the leadership. Otherwise, we'll always become extreme if you stay in a corner. But if you run to the leadership with your
ideas. I'll ask you in a different way. Is there any sign you see from the Israelis where people are adopting this notion?
Once the Israelis will catch that, yes, they can have their land, they can have their identity, and they can have peace and in the most liberal way. I'm not talking about doing to the Arabs what we did to ourselves in Gush Katif. This is not what I'm talking about, okay? I mean, when you're talking about expelling the Jews, it's of course it's nice, it's human, it's normal, it's not extreme. But encouraging and giving a lot of money to the Arabs, that's extreme and terrible. So it's all in the perception. Okay, you have to challenge the lies with the truth in a nice way, in a liberal way, in a human way. But that's not enough. You have to take it to the position of leadership, and this is what I do. So to answer your question, yes, the Israelis will accept that, and the Arabs are not. What's nice about the plan is that you're not asking them. You see, the problem with all other plans are that there are plans that involve the Egyptians, and there are plans that involve the Americans, and plans that involve this false Palestinian. Here, it's all in our hands.
I understand.
And it can be done.
Okay. Only because I'm going to lose you in a couple of minutes. You expressed yourself very, very well, and people have a right to judge it on their own. I want to ask you one more kind of question in the little time I have left with you, because I think people may misunderstand who
you are. I just want to make sure one thing. I'm not talking about taking 1 cent from the Israeli budget. Just transferring the same money that we spending on the concept of the two-state solution to the concept that this is our land.
Yes, you simply want to redistribute the way in which, at the moment, the current budget is spent,
right,
in some way on military.
Oh, definitely.
Okay.
You know, before Oslo, just I have to say one. Before Oslo, you did not need to have a guard in every coffee shop in Israel. you know, buses did not blow up. The concept of the Palestinian or the Arab suicide bomber did not exist before the Oslo concept.
It's ironic.
By the way, I wrote
that
the Twin Tower fell because of that handshake. The concept of the Islamic suicide bomber rised only after that handshake. It's interesting, but we don't have time to talk about it. That concept alone cost us 86 billion shekels since then.
If I had an hour with you, we would go further.
Okay.
But I just want a footnote, incidentally.
Yeah.
So Ben-Gurion made a horrible mistake. The Yishuv made a horrible mistake when they accepted the notion of partition in the 30s, 40s, etc.
Right.
Okay. Again, I want people to understand who you are. What do you want to do? You obviously care enormously about not only a biblical connection to the land, but the notion that God gave Haaretz, the Eretz Yisrael, to the children of Israel. And so this puts you, this defines you in some way as part of the, what is in America called the more Orthodox perspective. What do you want to do about religious pluralism in the state of Israel? To what extent do you believe there should be, within the state of Israel, some kind of prescribed Jewish law that all Jews have to follow?
I'm totally against it. I'm against halachic state or any kind of... I'm against the concept of religious parties.
Doesn't that make you so interesting? Because I would imagine many people now are surprised. They would have expected you to say the opposite. Explain why, given all the position you take, you still want a certain kind of religious freedom, Jewish religious freedom, within the state of Israel.
Look, the whole concept of Judaism is freedom. The message of freedom that, by the way, your country, the United States of America, took it from the Bible, from Yetziat Mitzrayim, from Exodus from Egypt, and so that this whole concept is that God wants us to have the right to choose. Okay, and every kind of force is against the basic concept of Judaism. We need to give our people the real right to choose. And I believe in the Jewish people. I believe in the Israelis. I am not afraid. I don't want to tell them that they're not allowed to buy chametz, for example, on Pesach. I know that when I will force it on them, they will. And when I will not, most of them will not. Exactly as we don't have a law that force every Israeli to make Brit Milah, and 99% of them doing so. The last thing I want is to force it on them. My basic message is that if you thought until today that you have to choose between identity and freedom, I said no. Only with your identity you'll have your real freedom. What did they do to us? The first thing they did to us when they sent us to the camps, when they wanted to take away our freedom, what is the first thing they did? They made us numbers. They took our identity, right? They made us numbers. This is the point. You want real freedom? Stick to your identity.
The only thing that upsets me is I have to let you go. You have to promise that we can continue this.
Oh, definitely. It was very interesting.
I hope you enjoyed it.
Look, next time.
Yes?
Let's talk about the Jews, not about the Arabs, okay? It's only about the Jews.
It's a deal. Hold on, you can go. You are a very important voice. It doesn't matter whether everybody agrees with you or not. It's important that you be heard. And I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you. I wish you kol tov v'hatzlacha. May you have success. May your voice be heard more and more. And if people have a good way of defending or disagreeing with you, they will. And who knows, it may be that at one point the Feiglin plan will become part of Israeli policy. It's been a great pleasure meeting you. Moshe Feiglin, who again is the deputy speaker of the Knesset. As always, I invite you to be in touch with me with any thoughts or comments you may have to some of the things that Moshe said. Please email me, write me, post on our Facebook wall, tweet me. I look forward to hearing from you. And if you want to be in touch with Moshe Feiglin yourself, you can do so by emailing me. I will forward you emails on to him. Until the next time, I'm Mark Golub. Be well, my friends.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support Shalom TV with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the Shalom TV website homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to GEM. To GEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive on DVD with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.